everyone here this morning. Invite you to take your Bible and be turning to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. It never gets old, but continues to be a constant source of joy to me when we come together on the Lord's Day and we partake of that supper the way we just did. It's an amazing reminder that even though we are fallen, sinful people, God loves us, that He gave that sacrifice, that we could become His children. I don't know about you, but I know that once again this week I failed. We are studying the fruit of the Spirit as we try and grow to reflect God better, to be truer reflections of His character and His nature. And every week, every day, that is my goal. I know it is many of yours as well. But every Sunday morning when we partake of the supper, I look back the week and I realize I don't know that I've ever had a week in which I partook of the supper and felt like that I had been perfect the week before. And by perfect, I mean a perfect representation of God's nature every hour of every day and every minute of every hour. That's why I'm so grateful for the blood of Christ. And as we continue our study of the fruit of the Spirit this morning, obviously such a study is for those who have obtained the Holy Spirit. The Scriptures teach us that when we obey the gospel of Christ, to believe in Jesus as the Son of God, to repent of our sins, to confess Him as Lord, and then to go down into the waters of baptism, that our sins might be washed away by the blood He shed on that cross. The Scriptures teach us that that blood justifies us. That word justified has long been one of my favorites, ever since one of my mentors told me in discussing the Greek meaning of that phrase. He told me it's very simple. It means just as if I had never done it. There may be this morning some who have not obeyed the gospel of Christ, therefore haven't received that Holy Spirit as the earnest of your inheritance, the guarantee that God will keep His promise we are loyal to. So I want to encourage you that even though the lesson is directed at those of us who have done that, recognize and consider your own need to take that first step. We'll read in 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 13. One of those many, many passages, those parallel passages that have to do with the nature and the character of God. And of course, Galatians 5, where we get our list for the fruit of the Spirit, is one of those passages. Matthew 5, 6, and 7, especially as displayed in Matthew 5 and the Beatitudes, is one of those passages. 1 Peter chapter 1 is one of those passages. He writes to the church there, and he says, beginning in verse 13, "Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior. Because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy." The people of God are commanded and must of necessity be a holy people, because we are that reflection of God. We are supposed to be growing in His character, in His nature, and He is holy. And so He makes that statement many times come out from among them and touch not the unclean thing, and be holy, for I am holy. And here in 1 Peter 6, I like especially Peter's statement there in verse 15 when he says, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior. That's why I know I missed the mark this past week. Am I conscious of an overt sin? Not necessarily. But I know that there were things I did that I shouldn't have done that weren't perfect reflections of God. And more than that, I know there were things that I should have done that I didn't do. There were times when I could have used my time more wisely. Times where, as we are so often, I was selfish. Now, I want to take you back to a thought I gave you last week, that because when we become Christians, we have that responsibility to begin growing in the fruit of the Spirit. And remember, by the way, our fruit this month, our aspect that we're focusing on is goodness. Goodness, you know, derived from godliness. The character, the nature of God.
Yeah.
And so, as we go through that struggle of still being fleshly, physical human beings, but also now being children of God and having been given His Holy Spirit, having that responsibility, therefore, not to grieve the Spirit with our sin, our transgression, but instead to be growing more and more like God. We have that civil war. That phrase seemed to resonate with some of you last week, so I wanted to tie you back into it. We have that ongoing civil war that goes on inside of us, where our flesh desires to do one thing because we are human, and our spirit desires to do another, our minds, because we are children of God and we want to reflect His nature. If I were to ask you the question, what was your first sin that you are aware of? I imagine that I could guess and be right a very high percentage of the time. Because I believe that if we think about it and consider our childhood, that we'll, most of the time at least, come up with the answer of dishonesty. So that's our subject this morning, one aspect of goodness that I wanted us to consider in this series, because it is godly to be honest. It is godly to be open and transparent, to be forthright. But it's not the way of man. We start lying early. And I don't know about you, if you can remember specific incidents, I can remember a few. But maybe it was simply throwing your ball in the house when you knew that was against the rules. And sure enough, something was struck and something broke. And then later when the question was asked by an absent parent, who broke this? It was old Ivan. That guy runs wild in a lot of households in North Carolina. And believe me, in a household of four boys with me and parents home much of the time, he was present a great deal. I remember some of the foolish lies I told as a little kid. I was thinking the other day as I was working on a lesson. Probably shouldn't tell you this, but we're being honest, right? I'm the youngest of four boys. I was the first in my family to cut school. I was 8 years old, thereabouts. And circumstances were such that on average school day, I walked myself the two or three blocks it was to my school. And at the end of the day, I walked myself home, and I was the first one home. do in those situations. And so I watched daytime television. And the thing that I watched was the game shows. And once those were over, I turned it off. But I'm walking to school the following week, and as I get right to the end of the school grounds, the thought occurs to me that I could turn around and walk back. Because when I got home, no one would be there, and I was the first one home anyway, so nobody would trip me up in the afternoon or anything. So I turned around, went back. Enjoyed it so much that a few days later I did the same thing. I did it 3 or 4 times before my dad was self-employed. Sometimes that can get you. And one day I'm sitting there in our living room, we have a small house and the main door opens right into the living room. And I'm sitting there watching my game show. And I hear keys at the door and I realize my dad has come home. I jump up, turn the TV off, I race to our bedroom. We lived in a little 2-bedroom house. My 3 brothers and I all shared a bedroom. And I scramble into that greatest of hiding places under one of those beds. Well, my dad had heard the TV as he was opening the door. As he told me later, he came in, even though it was off, because he clearly heard it, he put his hand on it. It was quite warm. He thought that it was a home invasion. He had a pistol, he gets out a pistol. He's going through the house, room by room, and believe it or not, he actually had the thought to look under the bed. I was surprised myself. I was under that bed, and I had gone all the way under. It was a double bed, 2 of my brothers here. I'd gone all the way under against the wall, and I turned my face against the wall. So I hear my dad's voice, after I heard him go into the room, you know. I hear him get down on hands and knees, and then I hear him say, "Chris." And I said, "Yes." And he said, "What are you doing under there?" See, then I begin, as lying always does, to build the falsehoods. What are you doing under there? You know, he didn't have your face pressed against the wall and back to him again. I said, "I'm looking for something." I was really on there. Really. He said, "What are you looking for?" Couldn't turn me up. It was winter time. I said, "A glove." He said, "Oh." He said, "Well, why aren't you in school?" And you know, it began to be great for me. When I look back on it now, just like you, I laugh at how poor my lives were. Why were they poor? Because I was just learning a lot. It was still new to me. That wasn't the first time I lied, I'm sure, but it was still new. We learned to lie in a lot of ways. We learned to lie watching our parents. You kids don't understand, but in the old days, you had one phone in the house. It was connected to the wall. You had a cord about that long, the shortest cord in those days. That phone would ring, someone in the family would raise the answer. That was a big deal back then. And then sometimes it'd be through your parents. And probably no parent here, having learned who was on the other end, has ever said, "Tell them I'm not here." What does a little kid learn? Oh, that's a white lie. It's been truly said that those who tell white lies regularly become color lies. We lose our ability to distinguish, and the truth gets further and further away from us. So we learn to lie in a lot of different ways. But the desire to lie is Let's, it doesn't have to be taught to us. It's a natural inclination when you're talking about the flesh. It's not a natural inclination when you're talking about the Spirit. And so we've seen here in 1 Peter 13 through 16 our call to grow in our holiness, to separate ourselves. That's the idea behind it. That's why I told you see the whole passage from the Old Testament. Come out from among them and touch not the unclean thing. Holiness is that idea of sanctification, being set apart. But since we live in the world, we have to continually choose to set ourselves apart. We have to continually choose to be holy. And it's not even just a once-a-day decision. It's an ongoing series of decisions throughout the day, every day, 7 days a week. That's that civil war. So, what does it say about the nature that we're truly grooming if we are not practicing honesty with ourselves, with one another, and with our communities at large? Well, one of the reasons, and one of the passages that I'm going to read to you is Revelation 21:8. Some of you, I've taught my little song on this. I won't try to sing that this morning. But Revelation 21:8 reads as follows: "But for the cowardly and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and immoral persons and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars, their part will be in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." Now, when you're reading that for the first time, and you're going through that list, cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, you're thinking, yeah, that's the kind of people that hell is composed of. I understand what he's saying. It makes sense to me. And then he says, "and all liars." And he put that last, the place of most significance. Why would God think of lying in these kind of terms? You see, it's because it's the very antithesis of his nature. The character of God and his honesty are diametrically opposed to one another. Listen to a couple passages from Proverbs. I'm going to read, I think I'll read Proverbs 12 first. Proverbs 12 says simply in verse 22, "Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who deal faithfully are his delight." Did you know that God has no stronger word, literally? He has no stronger word than the word abomination. That is the extreme of God's opposition when something is an abomination to him. Lying lips are an abomination. He who deals faithfully is his delight. And then maybe the more familiar passage, Proverbs chapter 6, beginning in verse 16, gives that famous list of seven things that God hates. I want you to listen carefully to that list with me. "There are six things which the Lord hates, yet seven which are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans and feet that run rapidly to do evil, a false witness who utters lies, and one who spreads strife among brethren." See, once again, like the Revelation 21:8 passage, you hear lying addressed in a list that has all of these things that we recognize are so terrible. And we get to lying and, oh, well, that's not so bad. But it's an abomination to God. And if you notice that list, seven things that God hates that are an abomination to him, did you notice that lying constitutes three of them? Lying exact opposite of the nature of God. Let me read one passage from the New Testament. One I'm sure you're familiar with, but maybe you haven't thought about the ramifications. John chapter 8, Jesus is speaking there. And he says in verse 43, why do you not understand what I am saying? It is because you cannot hear my word. You are of your father, the devil, and you want to do the desires of your father. There's the flesh, there's that civil war. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I speak the truth, he is not a liar. You see what Jesus is telling us here about the nature of Satan, the nature of the devil, and that nature is lying. He's the father of lies, you see. That is his nature. And when we give in to lying, we're not reflecting our God. We're reflecting Satan. We're reflecting his character and not God's character. Now, I want to go to the Sermon on the Mount for a minute. Show you a passage in Matthew chapter 5. Section that in my Bible is dubbed personal relationships in the heading. It gets down to verse 33. You remember what he's been doing here. He's been quoting the teaching of the rabbis to them concerning the law of Moses. Now, some people get confused. A lot of people get confused because they think he's quoting the law of God regarding the law of Moses itself. He's not quoting that. Study it, you'll see that he's quoting the interpretations that the rabbis have put on those original commands. And so in verse 33 there, he says, again, you heard that the ancients were told, you shall not make false vows, but shall fulfill your vows to the Lord. But I say to you, make no oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is the footstool of his feet, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Nor shall you make an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. But let your statement be yes, yes, and no, no. Anything beyond this is of evil. Now, maybe when I started reading that passage and you heard oaths, maybe it threw you off a little bit. But what is an oath? An oath is an attempt to guarantee the honesty of a statement or statements. And so we're very much talking about the same subject. And we couldn't have a better example. Number one, again, the importance of the issue, how honest, how highly Christians pride and honesty. Well, Jesus made it one of the topics in his Sermon on the Mount, and all by itself, that tells you a great deal about the importance of the subject. He's covering the basics about citizenship and his kingdom in the Sermon on the Mount. But he's dealing with the Jews, who were the people of God at that time, and they had this law of God, and he's dealing with their interpretation. Now, let me read you a passage from Leviticus 19 and see what it said on this subject, the law of Moses. Leviticus 19, verse 11 and 12 says, you shall not steal, nor deal falsely, nor lie to one another. You shall not swear falsely by my name, so as to profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. So they weren't to lie, and they weren't to swear falsely by God's name, because that profanes the name of God. Again, think about a lie in the first place, especially an oath or a promise. It's an attempt to lift our conversation to lift the things that we are saying to a higher level. A higher level of honesty. You ever been talking with someone and you said, well, be honest? Well, immediately when I hear that, I'm thinking, well, what were you being before? Or to tell you the truth. Now, I know and I understand that those are, you know, expressions that creep into our vocabulary. I've used some of them on occasion myself. But it should not be so. When you say that, you know what you've done? You've just gone beyond yes, yes, or no, no. I learned a long time ago, there are only three things you need to know how to say. You need to know how to say yes, you need to know how to say no, and you need to know how to say I don't know. And more lines done about the last one than probably any other. Why don't we let our yes be yes and our no be no? Why do we constantly go beyond? We feel that need because some part of us recognizes that we are often dishonest. When someone says those phrases to me a lot, I become alarmed. I think most of us have enough understanding to recognize that if somebody is constantly using those expressions, they are definitely somebody not to be trusted. Because they're continually worried that their word isn't good enough for you. Why are they that worried about it? Because they're in the habit of not being truthful. Now, when Jesus addresses this issue, he does it not because of the law that God gave, but because of the interpretation they made of it to cover their mind. Let's go to Matthew 23. Jesus is going to pronounce a series of woes here, beginning in verse 13. And we're going to go down to 16 and follow. And he's talking to these religious leaders now. He's talking to the Pharisees. Do you know what the word Pharisee meant? It meant separated. They were a later sect of Judaism that developed. And if you read their history, it reads like the Restoration movement. They developed because they saw that the people of God were building all these false interpretations and getting so carried away in their daily living from showing the character and nature of God that they cried out in protest and they formed a new division in Judaism. And they named them separated. They're the holy ones. That's why the people looked up to them so much. And yet, look at what these holy ones are doing. Jesus says to you, verse 16, woe to you blind guys who say, whoever swears by the temple, that is nothing. But whoever swears by the gold of the temple is obligated. You fools and blind men. Which is more important, the gold or the temple that sanctifies the gold? And whoever swears by the altar, that is nothing. But whoever swears by the offering on it, he is obligated. You blind men, which is more important, the offering or the altar that sacrifices the offering? Therefore, whoever swears by the altar, swears both by the altar and by everything on it. And whoever swears by the temple, swears both by the temple and by him who dwells within it. And whoever swears by heaven, swears both by the throne of God and by him who sits upon it. You know what they were doing? They created, literally, a gradation of oaths, of promises, a gradation of honesty, as if there could be such a thing. And their way around the explicit command of God on this subject that we read there in Leviticus 19 was that you missed the fine print, I would say. The fine print said, don't swear falsely attached to my name. And so they had endless debates and endless legal decisions. Those written decision based on whether you have to keep your word. How absurd. That'd be absurd for any group of people. But for the people of God, for the people called to be separate from the holy ones, it's ridiculous. And that's why Jesus addresses it in the Sermon on the Mount, and that's why he criticizes them so harshly here in Matthew chapter 23, because it's ridiculous for the people of God to have gradations to their honesty. What Jesus teaches us there in the Sermon on the Mount is that what we as the children of God need to do is to hold all of our conversation, all of our conversation, to the level of an oath. I hate it when people go to that passage in the Sermon on the Mount and what they take away from it is, I can't swear in court. That's not what he's talking about. Jesus swore in court. Paul swore in court. Yeah. He's talking about this kind of dishonesty. Not oaths that your society may call on you to make. Yeah. He's talking about deliberately phrasing things in such a way that you can break your word and yet claim to be innocent. Yeah. I never forget when I was a little boy, talk about learning about lying. I loved when I was a little boy, and I'm talking about when I'm 4, 5, 6 years old. I loved playing baseball with my 3 older brothers. That was one of my favorite things we did. I drove them nuts when I was that age, wanting to play baseball. And I had a special shirt, special t-shirt. I still remember, 4 or 5 years old. If we were playing baseball, I'd put that shirt on. I was on a baseball shirt. And I can remember one time begging my brother to play baseball, and my brother Greg finally told me, we will play baseball tomorrow, I promise. The next day, I said, all right, let's go play baseball. He said, no, we're not playing today. I said, you promised me that we'd play baseball. He said, no, I did not. I said, yes, you did. He said, no, I promised you that we would play baseball tomorrow. He said, is it tomorrow? And I said, I was 4 or 5 years old, and yet I knew I did. But he felt superior because he'd been able to rationalize what he said. We need to be honest. We need to be honest with one another. I have a passage in Ephesians here. I'm not going to take the time to read this morning. Go read Ephesians 4. Talk about how we treat one another. Notice that, one, we're to speak the truth in love, and two, we're never to lie to one another. We're to be people of honesty. We're not to tell white lies, we're not to tell any lies. We're to reflect the character and the nature of God. Every idle word that men shall speak, that it will give account thereof in the day of judgment. And you want to talk about a verse that scares me, that verse here. Every idle word. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. God is saying, let all of your conversation be held to the highest level. We should never be able to say, let me be honest with you, or let me tell you the truth. It should have always been on that same level if we were speaking. And the proverb says, in the multitude of words, there is sin. I've always thought of someone who likes to talk. Yeah. That was a scary passage too. It always makes me think of Jesus saying, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Because one of the ways that we get in trouble is we talk. So we need to be careful. We need to remember who we represent. And we need to remember the blood that was shed for us. In 1 John chapter 1, beginning in verse 5, he writes there, this is the message we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. See, when you tell that little white lie, you put a little darkness in your personal circle of whiteness. But in God, there's no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and yet walk in the darkness, and again, walk is your habit of life. So if your habit in life is to be dishonest, then you bring darkness into your personal circle. There's none in God. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as He Himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. That's the verse I remember every morning when we get it. He says in verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. Christians, let's strive to be a people of honesty. Yes, we'll miss the mark on faith. But if we're not striving, we won't even come close, will we? And if we're not striving, He won't continue to come. If we're not confessing our failures,